Hi, and thanks for watching. I'm Mike Pollock, voiceover actor. You might know me as the voice of Dr. Eggman in the Sonic the Hedgehog franchise, the interim narrator of Pokemon, or countless other animation roles. But that's not why I'm here. I'm here because the internet doesn't come with an instruction manual. Funny, neither did my kids. So I'm making some rare on-camera appearances to help us all clear up some online respect and etiquette issues. I don't mean how you talk to or about other people, although obviously cyberbullying is bad. Today we're going to talk about respecting copyright and copyright etiquette. You see, anyone can post anything to the internet, but there are some things that belong to other people, so you might not have the right to post those things without the owner's permission. Why? Because those things are protected by copyright. And sometimes some of that stuff gets posted without permission and has me in it, so naturally that catches my attention. In part one of this series, we spoke with intellectual property attorney Gordon Firemark about the nuts and bolts of copyright law. But for part two, I wanted to take that classroom knowledge and bring it into the field with some real-life scenarios and a hefty dose of opinion. And for that, I knew there was only one man to turn to, a great legal mind familiar to many from his dozens of television and radio appearances over the years.
But he couldn't be here tonight.
Unfortunately, William Kunstler passed away in 1995. So I'm honored to have as my guest. No, please. That's why. prosecutor, criminal defense trial lawyer, and the man behind LionelMedia.com, Lionel. Welcome,
you really
sir.
Were going to do that?
Absolutely.
I love that.
Thank you.
You know where I did that one time as a very serious joke? It was, we were honoring, the police athletically was honoring Marv Albert. And I said, we're here tonight to award, to honor a man today. And he was sitting there looking at me like, I know. Unfortunately, Jimmy Cannon's been dead for 40 years. Well, thank you very much for allowing me.
Thank you so much. Now, I paid good money for a movie or some music or a video game. Why can't I do whatever the hell I want with it and post it online, copy it for a friend, or what is this copyright thing and that keeps me from doing
okay,
that?
First of all, take it easy, okay?
Thank
Calm
you.
Down. I know you could, it's the voice actor in you.
It's what I do.
First, I want to start off by, is this, okay, you. Kids, we're going to be talking about you a lot tonight, and you mean no harm. I was a kid. I think I still am a kid. And people, kids, young people, and I don't like kids because it sounds demeaning, like you're stupid or something. But we're trying to convince them that what they're doing, something innocent, is stealing. You're stealing. And they're thinking, wait a minute, stealing is breaking into something. Stealing is going in and saying, I like that TV, I like that book, going in, trespassing, taking it, manucaption, asportating it away, that's larceny. No! Because something came along a while back, the idea of intellectual property. What a convoluted, highfalutin name. Copyrights, patents, trademarks, ideas, songs, because people made money. Now, right off the bat, I know somebody's saying, because you're thinking, I guess you maybe understand it intuitively, you know, but when somebody crafts a song or a piece of anything, your work, most of our labor, let's face it, most of us are in a service industry. And we do things that, well, we can, you know, lawyers or doctors or waiters or whatever it is, and we do something and we do this act and it's over with. We're done. And we can point to something which we've been paid for, but we don't create something. You know, we don't create a drink unless that drink is copied by others. So the idea, very simply, is that the law had to figure a way to protect those people who create something, whether it's a song, a piece of art. And I know people are saying, yeah, but here's the problem. When they're at home and they're looking at a screen or they're looking here, they're saying, but it's here. And intellectually and intuitively, it doesn't seem like stealing. Not only that, friends are doing it. And then what happens? You start generalizing and intellectualizing and moralizing. Wait a minute. You know, I'm not the only one doing this. And after all, maybe I'm helping Mike Pollock by taking one of your voices and letting the world know. And if I stop, what? That's gonna end piracy, and that's what people do. But it's still stealing. Is that too convoluted of an answer?
Works for me.
Well, I'm going to work on a harder one, because that's That's basically it. Nobody wants, nobody thinks they're stealing. And now for the first time, let me also, and please, if I interrupt Mike, sue me. But if I tend to be desultory and jump all over the place because it's the way I am. It was a blow to the head, occipital area, years ago. There's the law always lags behind technology. I'm a lawyer by profession, and these guys were great when it comes to, you know, 19th century property law. Here's a deed. I'm going to buy a piece of property. They're great with that stuff. You killed him. That's murder. Great. I'll draw you up a will. I hurt my neck in a car accident. I'll get you some money. That's easy. Here comes the internets, I believe, as someone said. Yes. All of the law and all of the statutes had nothing to do with this. Let's take fair use. What is fair use?
I can take a
little. Because kids, you're going to hear this all the time. I'm sorry, people.
I can take a little bit of a piece of a movie, of a song, and use it for a parody. Parody is protected by fair use. I used to write parodies professionally. For critique, I said, that was a horrible movie, and here's why this part, horrible. That sort of thing.
That's because you're not taking, but even fair use is even easier than that. I'm using it. Hey, I got this neat Bobby Rydell song. I'm going to make a cassette of it for my friend Mike.
Let's give the kids a moment to Google Bobby Rydell.
And a cassette.
Yes.
All right. That's fair use. Or, I'm having a birthday party. Can I play the Bobby Rydell song? Yeah, okay. And then you get into these stories. I don't know how true they are about the two sisters who owned Happy Birthday. Mm-hmm. And we're not going to cloud the issue, but that was basically fair use. Or, I got this great article on priapism, and I want to make a copy of it for my friend Mike, who has this condition. And I'm just going to zero. Wear a long coat, nobody will notice. I'm going to Xerox this. Remember that? I'm going to mimeograph. I'm going to make a cut. That's fair use. So I'm replicating it, and I'm using it. But the real reason why that wasn't a problem is that, so what? Two copies, three copies, and if I read this great book, Ulysses. I'm going to go to the public library and copy every one of the 1,000 pages. So practically speaking, and in cassette, second, third generation, this was before digital, after a while nobody could hear it. It wasn't a problem. It wasn't a problem either because nobody abused it or the technology didn't allow it to become a problem. Nobody worried about it. Nobody ever worried about somebody taking, you know, Stairway to Heaven and making 1,000 or 1,000,000 cassettes. Okay. Enter this. My phone. No, enter digital binomials. Changed everything. So what happened was we looked at the law and said, have we adapted? No, not really. Because it's a duplicate. It's an actual
perfect
duplicate. Now,
perfect.
If I'm getting too ahead of the game here, let me give you an example. It's not just this. It's changed everything. I mentioned before we started this, even in courtrooms, there's problems with authenticating pictures. People can take a picture and Photoshop it and change it, and sometimes you can see it, sometimes you can't. So the bottom line is this. Here comes YouTube. Now, if I'm, by the way, I don't want to keep saying kids, but I'm your friend. If I were you, I'd say, well, how do you explain YouTube then? What does YouTube do? Did they pay royalties for all this stuff? I can go, and I love YouTube. I'm addicted to YouTube. I play YouTube pachinko. I'll start off with this. Mm-hmm. Bobby Rydell, that end up with the history of Syria.
17 hours later.
Yes, I don't know how I got there. But did YouTube pay for all this? I've seen full documentaries, full movies, radio shows, albums in their entirety. And you know what they always say at the end? Hey, I don't know about any kind of copyright claim. I'm just putting it up. I hope I'm not breaking any law. And then you're asking a young person, wait a minute, you're busting my chops about it? What about YouTube? How do they get away with it? I don't know.
That's why, to the kids, I'm saying, I'm not your dad. I can't tell you not to do something. But I can at least try to educate you so you know what maybe you shouldn't be doing. Because maybe you didn't know it was wrong. That's why we're here.
But also, there's a thing I want people to understand. Let's talk about your work, all right? You get paid for this. And it's a gift you have, and you have to audition, and you have to read scripts, and you have to, for every job you get, you've got 10 or whatever number that people may have turned you down. So it's your job. It's who you, it's what you do. And if all of a sudden the Mike Pollack works becomes so diluted and so omnipresent that, that again, why should I hire you? I've already got your stuff.
Exactly.
And wait till eventually we get into like CGI for voices. We won't even need you. Because there was a time when we used to have stuntmen. Now, CGI, we don't have that. Eventually, we're not going to have, we're going to have synthesized voices. So that's a problem, too, in the future. But the problem is what you're trying to say is you're getting paid for this. And if you want to get compensated for every time somebody uses your thing, that's it.
Right. And also the people that are trying to make money selling the finished pieces, if anyone can go and see them for free online on YouTube, that's going to dilute the sales of the videos. And then there'll be less money to pay me to go to do the next job.
Remember people like years ago when Jerry Garcia and the Grateful Dead came along and said, hey, bring your, record our stuff. Go ahead. Oh, the RIAA and all these guys, BMI and all these, hated that because they said, go ahead, tape us. That sounded wonderful because corporations seemed, confiscatory and mean and how dare you. What about the music? And going back to music or videos, what if somebody says, all right, I took this. Can I pay you for this? This is out of print or I can't get it anymore. What do I do then?
I came up with the idea of a micropayment licensing system, which obviously you'd have to get the content creators to go along
You're
with.
You're so hardcore. You just... Money.
My family has this addiction to food, clothing, and shelter. Right. I can't help it. But if copyright owners would agree to, I'll pay you a dollar if I can use this on YouTube, oh, sure, that'd be great, which highly unlikely to happen, but that might solve some of the problem.
Well, let me ask you this. You would know more about this than I, because in terms of the practical aspects of this, I like Spotify and Pandora. I don't really pay for them. I mean, I may pay for the deluxe version where I can eliminate commercials and that sort of thing. But somebody's paying for that. How are millions of songs able to be played by me over and over and over again as much as I like? How do they survive? What did they do? Let me go through a couple of points here legally. And this is why some folks, adults and youngsters as well, may wonder. There's a problem called waiver. When you're a company and you let too much piracy, too much stealing go by without you doing something affirmatively to stop it, you're in essence, you might be waiving any claims you have. Here's a classic example. Let's talk about adverse possession. I went to school with her cousin. Anyway, adverse possession. For years, you know that your property actually is 6 feet over the property line and you're actually in the neighbor's property and you build houses, you moved your patio and everything in your rumpus room and you're on their property. It's yours. And for 7 years or 21 years, 7 years I think it is, or what, who knows, 21, 7, I get them confused, but you have done this. If after a while nobody has said anything to you, you can go and reclaim your deed because you now own that because you've been open and in the open and notorious, as it's called, and you've done it. Well, all they would have to do, your neighbor, is say, by the way, Mike, I don't mind the fact that you're staying there. I know what you're doing. If they acknowledge it, if they tell you to stop, then they at least protect their claim. What does all this mean? It means this. Sometimes you hear this story about some guy. Remember when Napster came around? Somebody was hit with a $25 billion lawsuit because he downloaded a million songs. And you wonder, whatever happened to those people? Why are they suing? Are they going to sue me? Can they sue me? Who's going to give me up? Can I go to the people as a defense and say, hey, don't look at me. Look at YouTube or look at whatever. Because they're going to do that. Now, the question is, a practical point of view is, well, if you sue a kid or somebody, can you do that? If you sue somebody with no money, does it matter? But remember, that got my attention when some person got sued for $30 million, and these people are serious. So the question you have is, what happens if you think you are breaching? What's going to happen to you? How do you know? What if you've got a slew of, unpaid for, stolen stuff? Here is the question. I don't know. And it depends. Remember the expression, if a tree falls in the forest, nobody's there to hear it? Mm-hmm. Well, if you do something and nobody sues you, is it wrong? Yes, but if you shoot somebody and kill somebody, but nobody, you never get arrested, it doesn't make it wrong. It just means that you haven't been stopped. So just because you have not been sued, just because you don't know anybody who has received a cease and desist or an injunction, just because that hasn't happened doesn't mean, number one, that what you're doing is not wrong or that it won't happen in the future.
So don't be surprised if you should be carted away in handcuffs. Just don't say we didn't warn you.
Well, and some of these, some of these do have criminal penalties to it. You know, and because they're civil and criminal. Civil is money. We want basically you to stop, or we want you to pay us a fee for this. Criminal is we want to put you in prison. And depending upon how bad it is or egregious it is, here in New York, you see all the time of people buying knockoff purses and bags, blatant counterfeit. Now, we also have problems. What do you do with countries who do this, who are known to do this?
The countries that own us, with the thousands of products that are sold in major retailers, who shall remain nameless. Now, kids today like to put up boilerplate disclaimers on their content. I'm not claiming that I own this. You had said earlier that might do more harm than good.
Well, you're also putting someone on notice that you're even aware of it. So it's hard to claim the little old me defense when you're saying, hey, look, and you use words like fair play. Be careful of boilerplate anything. Don't put in statutes like, hey, I think it's pretty cut and paste. Control V, well, that looks great. Section 2, United States Code, but stop. I just had, recently we did some contract work where somebody decided to take a movie deal contract and just threw in words, and I waive injunctive relief. You do? So don't do that. So that's not going to help anything. However, here's a million-dollar question. If somebody watching says, all right, Mike, you're right. I see the error of my way. What do I do to comply? How do I know when this is a violation? Do I call someone? Do I wait and see? I got it off of YouTube. What about, who is YouTube? Well, that's the Google folks. Yes. And I don't know. So, number one, I can't tell you, absolutely, because unless somebody sues you, or unless somebody shows you the statute, and in some of these copyright cases, especially, remember in the old days, when people would go to, in music publications, somebody would go to a bar, and they listen all night long. They were playing music in jukebox, and they would write down every song they played. And at the end of the night, this BMI or ASCAP or some investigator would say, tonight, you played 125 songs. Multiplied by treble damages, meaning we take a presumptive statutory damage, multiply it by 3, and you owe us $25 billion. And that was serious. That has happened to people before. That was easy to quantify. I don't know what to tell you if I were to, God forbid, purloin something you've done. Am I stealing from you, the owner? Is it? And it's on YouTube!
Could a blanket licensing type of deal like radio has now where, okay,
sure.
Radio stations, could that work on YouTube?
Absolutely. And I think people would love to do this because remember something. If you love this great man's work, and if you love voices and cartoons and that, and you want to make that business real lucrative, real profitable. So by paying something, or saying, slip in a fee somewhere, I won't even see it. You're going to encourage more people to get into the business, to do more cartoons and more voices and more. It's going to make it something that years ago was who? Mel Blanc and
Doss Butler, June Foray, bless her heart, still with us.
Okay. Well, so you know the names. I just know Mel Blanc. But today, with voices, with the proliferation of what cartoons are, because cartoons, when I was a kid, cartoons were kind of baby-fied with the exception of maybe Bullwinkle. But it's different now. So if they were to allow or to provide a licensing fee like that, that would be terrific because it would actually encourage people to do what you do.
Of course, the challenges of getting kids with no money to pay money is, yeah, best of luck with that. Speaking of money, does monetization, mon, mon, easy for me
easy
to say.
For you to say, yeah.
Does monetization make a difference? If you're posting it and you have a monetization agreement with YouTube that you'll get money for so many views, does that make a difference as far
well?
As
it's funny you say that. Anytime you make money from something, that changes a... Because just in terms of the human kid, not only is this kid stealing from us, but he's making money. There is something in law, in torts, civil law, torts from the Latin tortius, meaning twisted, you were harmed, tort law, not criminal, called privacy. And privacy law meant that if I were to expropriate or steal or use your voice, caricature, likeness, you, and I make money. And I, for some reason, I put your picture in a sign, or if I, whatever, I can be sued by basically using something of yours. So what's interesting now, what people know is, in addition to the copyright and intellectual property, there may be something, you're using something of mine or me. Because here's the thing, the internet takes whatever the problem was before and magnifies it. Libel and slander. Libel and slander is very simple. Libel and slander are basically making false statements against somebody. If it's recorded, if it's documented, if it's written, it's libel. If it's said one time, if it's fleeting, it's slander. Less bad because you said it and, all right. Now, in the internet elevates, there's an old joke. I'm so depressed, why? My father's a town drunk. That's not so bad. New York? Okay. Well, it's one thing if I said, guess what? I called Mike Pollack a communist. Oh yeah, that's not too bad. On the internet? It's got 50 million hits. Now, going back to my dusty law books, we don't have anything really for where it was said. It was just, we looked at it, so we don't know about that in terms of how scandalous. Again, I don't know. So going back to your question, if somebody's making money off of this, does that change it? Yes, it changes the equation because not only are you stealing it, but you're profiting. And that puts you into the privacy area as well. Remember also, think this, and it rarely goes to a jury, but imagine explaining this. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, not only did this, the little Bumpy over here, Bumpy, what kind of a name? Anyway, little Toby, you know, steal this, but he was selling it. He was making money. And immediately, it's like, that changes. So that, you can almost hear that. That changes the complexion, and that will change the degree of wrong, unfortunately, and the reaction in terms of the money.
Now, here's something that I'm sure the law has not caught up to, but your opinion, that's why you're here. There's a lot of the kids that have seen the first video in our series. If you haven't seen it, take a moment, go watch it. About a thing called the Let's Play, where...
This sounds creepy.
It, in a way, it is. Kids will record themselves playing the game, so you're watching just a screen
right.
of a video game.
Okay.
Video games, by their nature, are designed to be pliable and can go in any number of different directions. Is that a fair use thing because you're putting your own spin on something, or are you because you're adding commentary to it? What is that just?
That's a fascinating question.
Thank you.
What if I said for you, you wrote a song, you light up my life. Boy, that's really a Debbie Boone.
I'm sorry, what?
I know. Don't laugh. But I remember when that was the number one hit for one long summer.
As do I.
So I'm say, I'm going to go online and I'm going to, assuming there's whatever the hit was, and I'm going to record, you know what I'm going to do? Record me and I'm going to be sampling my new piano that I bought. And I'm going to happen to be playing this song. And I'm going to happen to upload that song. But what I'm uploading is not the song. It's me playing the piano. I just happen to be playing that song. Well, what you're talking about this is, I'm not stealing your game. I'm playing your game. I'm not cracking the binomial codes. I'm not doing a knockoff. I'm just playing it. And I'm talking about it. I'm reviewing it. I'm doing maybe a parody. What if I make fun of it? I'm going to teach, and I'm sure I've told you this, but there is the answer to every legal question that I've ever known is what?
It depends.
It depends. I swear to God. It's so that's
that question. The answer also comes up when you ask questions about my father-in-law's incontinence problems, but that's another matter.
Well, also, let me ask you this much. Libel, slander, you said parody and all that. There's something that's coming up right now. This is where Yelp and all these online food, because everything now is, we're just commenting on everything. You know, oh, I went to this taco place. It was the worst place. And a lot of times, the competitor of that place is posting these. Is that libel or slander trade? I don't know. And it's hitting, again, the multiplicative aspect of the internet. This is my opinion. This is parody. This is opinion. Is that maybe in the old days it was, but when you take somebody that's, it's an opinion, but it's seen by a million people, something that the law cannot take into. The factoring of the enormity of the internet. See, the internet knows no, if I steal something, I can't break it up into a million pieces and sell it. If I steal a watch, I got to sell it to one person. But if I could make copies of it and sell it, this knows no corollary in the real world. So the law is still making up its mind. Not only that, you're trying to say, where do we start? You know, where do we start? I'm going to sue a kid? And I don't think you can. You would have to appoint a, they don't have the capacity to do that.
So the parents take responsibility for the kids? I'm asking because I have kids. So if you can assume my children, please leave me out of it.
Interesting question. There has been, in many jurisdictions, there are statutes that have limited liability for specifically intentional torts, intentional crimes, up to like $5,000 and, you know, vandalism. Again, see, this is old. We have these stupid laws that say, yeah, but a kid just wiped out a, you know, he basically took the Beatles catalog and put it online. It cost him $1 billion. Tommy did that? Yes. So the laws that we had before don't work because, again, of the factor of the internet. A little screw up before. It's like if you have a fender bender at 30 miles an hour versus 150 miles an hour, it's different. Same thing with this. So I love that playing.
Mm-hmm. It's a lot of uncharted territory we're covering.
Well, let me ask you, what's your beef? If somebody's playing, they go, hey, this is great. They're not, are they using your thing, your game, your?
It's, I guess since it's a game, if you're selling games for people to play it, then you can't really get that much enjoyment out of watching someone else play it. I know I personally, not being a gamer, find watching someone else playing a game to be boring after the first minute and a half. I get it, he's running, he's jumping, he's running, he's jumping, he's running again, he's jumping. I get it. So I guess watching someone playing a game when you are trying to sell your games to let other people actually play them, probably not going to damage too many sales from just watching the game. But still, all the artwork, all the music, all the other elements are protected by copyright, and you don't have permission to put those up.
Yeah, but I would argue in that case that you're... Unless you put on headphones or something, and then you know, you can... I mean, are you really... If I hear a tinny background noise of... I mean, you're right, technically speaking, but I'm with you in terms of trying to grade that damage, that theft, that... Listen, I love things where people find new ways to enjoy hanging out. Have you ever been to or heard of a Mac party when you get your Mac and you take it out of the box? They have these...
The unboxing?
Yeah. I thought, the first time I heard that, I thought, this is old, not probably. I said, you're kidding me. I've seen YouTube's...
Unboxing videos.
Now that's okay. That's part and parcel of it, I guess. I like the tutorials on... I'm just saying that I love that. We have to accept that with this new thing, this every bit of technology, we're going to have to give something up. I'm sure in the old days, somebody said on the phone, hey, did you hear my new Victrola? And, you know, Thomas Edison, damn it, you know, he's...
Mary had a little lamb. I do voices.
One of my favorites.
Thank you.
So... And by the way, if he ever became completely demented, how would we know?
That's true.
You could say, doctor, he's making voices. He does that.
Exactly.
So that, I think, I would probably side with the gamer who wants to take a video of it, because I think damages would be really tough to show.
Yeah, especially with the new generation of flat screen TVs, where apparently the only way to record them is to hold your phone up in front of the TV and make an awful recording. Look, it's a TV picture and it's like this. So if that's the quality that's going to end up,
Who watches that? I mean, who?
It's.
Have you looked at, for example, some YouTube thing, and it's got 1,000 hits?
Yes.
Who's watching this?
Yes.
Find those people, have them committed.
Absolutely. Now, the dreaded Digital Millennium Copyright Act that is tried to make the law catch up with the internet, how's that affecting things? Is that actually helping things? Because that covers things like breaking the copy protection and copyright in the online world. Is that helping anything?
Well, it depends.
Thank you.
Let me throw one at you, and this is what I wanted to discuss, which I find fascinating. The government, and by the way, the government is not Obama or Bush, whatever. The government is this group of people who are the Department of Justice or Commerce or the White House, whoever is in power, are going to be using copyright in ways as a means of gaining entree into something more nefarious. What does that mean? I don't know. No, I'll tell you. This is the greatest, just stop for a second. People talk about how the internet started. It was really DARPA. It was really defense research. It wasn't Al Gore. And the government, understand, turned their back and it was gone. The genie was out of the bottle and they don't know what to do. There is a concerted effort by all governments to get this thing back in. You don't want people to be able to communicate. Games and all this is communication. This is what it is. There was a special one time, I was watching Shelby Foote or somebody talking about Civil War, and they said, what would have changed a Civil War? I mean, what would have been some of the most drastic change? Machine guns, nuclear bomb, what? He said, no, two walkie-talkies would have eliminated half of the battle. They couldn't communicate. Now we have this. In Vietnam, work with me now, I'm getting to a point.
Google it.
In Vietnam, you would have a film of something, My Lai. They would have to take a roll of film on a plane, go to the Philippines, have a process, go to New York, and then 6 weeks later, you'd learn about the My Lai massacre or whatever it was. This is now instantaneous. In 2009, in Iran, a woman named Netta, a young woman, was shot by a sniper. Somebody took out their phone, immediately took a picture, uploaded it, and 2 hours later in Los Angeles, they had T-shirts. She was a martyr. 2 hours later. So this, governments are saying, this is not good. This is not good. Hey, the revolution's starting now. Great for disaster. So what are they trying to do? Okay, using copyright protections. And what you're going to be seeing now is this. You're going to be seeing a new device that Apple and others have already announced that they've got that can turn off recording. And they're going to use copyright as the reason for that. So when you're in a concert and you've got this phone, they want to make sure for the copyright protection, intellectual property, which is what we're talking about now, we're going to have this little beam that somehow is going to deactivate these things. And then one day, police officers and federal agents will have that same beam before they club you or do something nefarious. Again, the government has no idea what to do. They're using copyright. What that long, circuitous explanation meant was, do not be surprised if you see some very serious folks get real serious about copyright, not so much because they care about you and your voices, but to create this meme, this theme that copyright is serious so we can bring in all this new technology like this that can turn off phones. There's an effort now to be able to turn this thing off, to stop tweets, or to go back and to retro locate tweets and to find out who these people are. This has changed everything. The good news is for people who want to steal and pirate and revolt, and there's just so much going on now. Governments have no idea what to do. Let me tell you what else is happening. For the first time, why are we stuck with this idea of internet and copyright alone here. Here's my question. Where is the violation? Let's take gaming laws. You can't gamble in New York. But if I'm gambling online, that server may be in the Cayman Islands. It may be in Qatar or Doha, where it's legal. Where is this? I don't know. Where is the Pokemon? Is this federal? Now, a couple things happened recently. Some states, the BRICS countries, Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa, are coming up with a thing called BRICS cable. They want to have their own alternate internet. So one day you may say, this is illegal for American internet, but is completely okay in this other internet where we have a treaty where it says there is no intellectual property. If there is no, if we're in North Korea and there is no intellectual property laws, how can Norway, what if you're doing something here and all of a sudden you get an injunction from Bahrain that says lay off and you say, I don't know what you're talking about. The internet, again, extra jurisdictional. It was easy in the old days. Treaties, fly over, a radio signal only went so far, a satellite maybe. So in a couple of months, if not years, but gaming piracy is going to be the least of the problem. Mm. I know that's why we're here. And I don't mean to go off into other tangents.
Please.
But you've got to see the big picture of this because nobody saw this coming.
Here's a question. Speaking of the phone, say there's a crowd of people who come upon a tragic news event and everyone is taking their own pictures. Who owns the copyright on those
Fantastic.
Pictures or that scene?
Oh, that is right.
That just occurred to me.
What happens if you're an eye reporter? Hey, got some good pictures of the snowfall. Send them in to be an eye reporter. Who owns that? Well, in the old days, you know, they have these. I saw a great piece on iconic photographs. It was the Vietnam again of the street execution. The young girl covered in napalm, running nude and screaming. The monk self-immolating and. They change everything. And those people won the Pulitzer. Today, you got 1,000 of these. Let me ask you a better one. We just had the 50th anniversary of JFK's assassination. What if we had 1,000 cameras that day? 1,000 angles. Nobody's even seen this before. And also the idea of, what about the picture? Let me go back to going, I hope I'm not too, but I want to show the complexity of this.
That's why the fast forward button was invented. Skip
what
ahead.
What does that mean? What is that?
If you don't find this interesting, which I do, you can skip ahead. I'll be here.
Now, in the old days, child pornography was very easy to understand. It was a very simple law that said the reason why we don't want you to do it, obviously, is a couple of reasons. Number one, it's the commission of a crime. Number two, you're memorializing the crime. So you're doing something awful, and then you're recording it, and it can be shown again so the child suffers it by virtue of the replication of the showing, and also it encourages people to engage in that kind of behavior by making it profitable or whatever. Okay, fine. CGI and Photoshop come along and they say, got an idea for you. What if we take the face of a child and put it on the body of an adult? I just forgive me. I find this disgusting that anybody would even want to do this, but we morph them together. And you can say, ta-da, that's not a child. No child, no animals were injured. No child was involved in this. They said, well, you can't do that. Why not? And then what happens is laws try to write. Well, because you cannot depict in any way. What about Romeo and Juliet? What about Lot's wives? What about the Bible? What about, well, that's different. Why is that different? I don't know. Remember, the law always lags behind. So what happens if I take one of your games, your voices, and I change it? How much can I change it? If I have a cocaine molecule and I put a methyl group or a hydroxyl group on it, and it feels like cocaine to you, but it ain't. It's different. How different can I get? What if I take one of your voices and I change it a little bit more? And I say, that's not you. It's a girl who happens to sound exactly like you. The question then is, am I confusing one with the other? That's going to happen.
Mm-hmm. You've often made the point about those online child pornography stings where they're communicating with a police officer who's not actually a child.
That's even more. I know this is straying beyond what we're
doing. It's a fascinating tangent about to launch into.
No, but the point is, again, it goes to show you what I'm talking about. The law has no idea of this thought crime business. There are people, you've seen To Catch a Predator with Chris Hansen, and these people are sick. You know, when they show up, he goes, hey, the guy shows up and he's got condoms and wine coolers, and he thinks he's going to meet this 14-year-old girl. He's been online talking to a 45-year-old police sergeant named Chick from Palm Beach County. There's no child there, but he thinks there is. So he shows up, and he says, where's the girl? All right, I'm Chris Hansen. And they arrest him. For what? Because he thought he was engaging in some type of assignation or some type of an agreement to meet with a child. But there was no child. But he thought there was. There's something very troubling about that. I understand there's something troubling about somebody who even thinks about that. But I give the analogy. What happens if somebody's walking down the street and they're blind and they're drunk and they're blind drunk and they walk up a point. They think somebody's in front of them, but there's nobody there. He pulls out a gun and says, stick him up. And he robs somebody he thinks is there, but there's nobody there. Can you charge him with robbery? No. But he thought there was somebody there. That's thought crime stuff. That's really, again, why? Because the law lags behind technology. It doesn't know what to do with this. It doesn't know how to handle. So going back to what I said before, if I can take a picture and I can morph it, if my CGI is so good, you can't tell the difference. Is that what it is? How much of you can I morph? How much can I change? How much of it? You tell me, because then copyright goes back into likeness and confusion. And if I say, oh, that's a Mike Pollock. It's a Jackson Pollock, too. That's a Mike. That's Speedy Gonzalez. Prove it's not. I've always heard, Barney.
The dinosaur or the caveman?
No. Or was it the Barney?
Barney Fife, Barney Rubble. Fife. Google it, kids.
I know. No, but like, I love you.
Yes, Barney the dinosaur.
You love me. You know what that is? This old man. How'd you get away with that? Well, it's fair use. I love this one. Well, it's been around for such a long time. We all can sing it now. So how similar can I be to that? I don't know.
Parody.
It depends.
Thank you. Parody is fair use, the Supreme Court has said.
Parody is different. Parody is when the great Supreme Court case where Larry Flint did, remember the Campari moment with Jerry Falwell? All these kids are going, what is he talking about? Larry Flint. But it was terrible. My first time, it was terrible depiction of incest or whatever. But the Supreme Court said he clearly did not.
The aristocrat.
Yeah, exactly. The aristocrat. But so parody is one thing, opinion is another. I don't know. But going back to copyright in this, our initial point is we get done with this, and a young man or young woman says, Mom, Dad, I've turned over a new leaf. I'm going to stop this. What this is, I hope, is I want people to say, That's it. Just so that you can say, I never thought about that. That's interesting. I never thought, that's interesting. Wow. I have a friend of mine. His name is Bobby Weinstein. And he wrote, Going Out of My Head. Forget it. Everybody knows it. Everybody. And he, to this day, every single time somebody somewhere plays it, he gets a check. Isn't that great? And you know what? Because of him making money like that, making a lot of money, other people, when they go to their parents and say, Mom, Dad, I want to be a songwriter, like Bobby Weinstein, like Jimmy Webb, they say, you know what? Good for you. Why? Because it's lucrative. Because it there's something to that. It's making something. The only way you can understand this is to feel the sting when you've been ripped off. When you're a comedian, somebody takes a joke or takes a bit or takes a, that's another thing too. But if you imagine you're in school, and what is our age range here? I don't want to be too silly here.
It's 8.
Okay,
plus.
Good. Imagine you've painted the most beautiful flower, whatever it is, and it's up on the more, it's fantastic. And they're saying, this is great, Mike Pollock, that's great. That's the best whatever it was that you painted. And then some kid next door in another class walks by and says, well, I can do that. Copies the identical picture you did. And now they're talking about him. And you say, wait a minute, I did that. Sue me. I just took, it's not yours. No, you stole my ID. That's me you took. No, I didn't. I did that. Then it kind of starts to make sense. But right now, now listen, when you're a kid or an adult and you're sitting there and you're saying, okay, I'm going to do this. And by the way, I'm going to have a t-shirt made that says, you're looking at the only person who has ever destroyed all of his copyright, me, because I'm a schmuck, because I saw this Mike Pollock video and I felt so bad that I'm the only one who did it. But it's one of those things where, let me tell you, there are two kinds of crimes, malum prohibitum, malum in se. Malum prohibitum means it's wrong because you say it's wrong. Not filing income tax, running a red light. There's malum in se, killing your grandmother with an ice pick. Oh my God, that's hard. You don't have to explain to people why. Yeah, but she was old. There's that feeling of, that's not right. Stealing your sister's money that she was saving by washing cars and babysitting. She was going to buy this dress and you stole it. Stop. We got that. Try telling somebody this is on par with that. Is it really? Let me see something, Pollock. Let me see. This is the P&L statement. This is the quarterly statement from whatever.
The police blotter.
No. This is Microsoft or Apple, whoever it is. This is what they made last 20 minutes ago. My theft is not on here. You're telling me I'm going to, the end of civilization as we know it. People are going to say, remember that? The year 2013, it all stopped. No more cartoons, no more voices. Why? Little Billy Lipschitz. He stole Mike Pollock's voice and the world stopped. It's not going to happen. But as long as you think about it, because what morality is what you do when nobody's watching. That's what morality is. It's what you do on your own where you say, I can't do that. And we all have that sense, I can't,
If enough people watch this and at least one kid says, I didn't realize that was wrong, then I think we've made our point.
Or appreciate what you're doing and appreciate the fact that what you're doing is art. That's another thing too. We need to do more of this in schools and push people into dance and theater and singing. And that. But when you can do a voice, when you say, I've created this thing, I've done something, I've created it out of nothing, me, a song, that will last forever. I mean, it's that important. So if you're able to at least convey that, and if I've been able to help through this, what is it? We're like the 12th hour we're into this thing?
Just growing up. Stubble I mean, happening.
Right. All of a sudden you see time lapse. See some plant.
Webs. Planting off. Yes.
Some plant that starts growing. It's like, that was a ficus. Excuse me. Kids are watching. Ficus is a plant.
But there's, and with all the copyrighted stuff, there is tons of original material on YouTube too. I've been part of some original animations that have been created completely from scratch. So it's not as though all that's happening.
Now, can people take this? Can they take this?
And redistribute it?
Sure. Nobody's paying for this.
No, it's a public service. So it's yours to share. Don't obviously change all the messaging. We edit it so we're saying disgusting things. We'll do that later.
But what's important about YouTube and why this is critical is that years ago, the only way you could do something, you could be an actor or you could be an actress or you could film. I mean, the camera people, great people, got great equipment. And the reason why is because they're able to get that. This, 40 years ago, would have been unseen. Then they get this, but prior to the internet, what would they have done? Now you can actually produce, you can edit, you can put your own bands together. The idea of going to a record label, a publisher? Why? Why? This is the greatest thing that's ever happened. It's a delivery system. It's changed everything. And that's why it will help art. And it will help. But if people are getting ripped off, if people want it, you never want this. You never want somebody to say, you know what? I could sure bring a lot of pleasure to children in their lives. I really could. But I don't want to do it because they're going to rip me off. You don't want to be another Mike Pollock. You heard his story. He lost everything.
He used to be somebody
right now. But you don't want that. So think of it that way. Just, if you can, pay when you can. Think about it. Don't wear a hair shirt. Don't, you know, self-flagellate. That's not what you think. But just consider what you've done and what you're doing and how evil it is.
Now, last question, purely my selfish question. I like to point out to people that the work I do is work for hire, which means I'm doing it for someone else. They own all the copyrights. They pay me. I got my money. I go away. However, deep in my heart, I feel as though I owe it to my clients to defend their copyrights. Not that I have any legal responsibility to do so, but I feel bad for the people that have given me money to be in their thing, and now someone is online giving it away without permission. Is that wrong of me?
No. That shows a heart, and also if you respect what they do. And it's just wrong. That moral alarm in you has gone off. It's just wrong. And the best part of it is that people do not know oftentimes that what they're doing is, I mean, there are these nefarious countries out there and factories that you know, do knockoffs. That's not what we're talking about. That's deliberate, that's kleptocracy or whatever you want to call it. This is different. But it's not wrong to be concerned because it's stealing the art. And especially somebody that you want to deal with, when you see all the amount of effort and time and money that they've invested to have it taken away and stolen by somebody who doesn't see it, that's the best part. Because this is, I used to always say that DUI is the only offense that people never really planned to commit. Everything else you plan, we're going to kill that guy, I want to shoot that. This is different. So nobody really sits there and says, you know, I'm stealing. This is great. I'm going to steal some more. I don't even want this song or this game, and I'm going to steal it because I like stealing. It doesn't work like that. Because at home, because remember, within this parameter, this is your world. This is it. This is my world. I'm not going anywhere. If it's here, it's fair game. I didn't pop this thing. I don't know who sent me this. I'm just sitting here, and if I can hear it once, I can hear it 1,000 times. And I don't see anything wrong with that, because within this screen, within that game, within that particular screen, that's my world. That's my reality. And that's not, and I don't go into your house. I don't even leave my room or my parents' basement.
Yes, thank
you. I sit here all day long with a.
He said it, kids. I didn't say it.
With a Cheeto-colored, you know. But that's the mentality. They don't see it, and I understand why.
I think, I hope, we've taught you something. I am delighted to have you as my guest.
It was my pleasure, dear friend.
Thank you so
much. My pleasure.
Any questions, you'll find me online, you'll ask me questions. We'll have more Q&As as time goes by because people have more questions. Lionel, thank you so much.
Thank you.
And scene.